नमस्कार, दिलीप सिंह एडवोकेट. यू आर मोस्ट वेलकम टू माय चैनल जर्नी ऑफ कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन ऑफ इंडिया. लेट मी शेयर यू विद अ स्टोरी. ए मैन हैज थ्री सन्स एंड वन डॉटर. ही बिल्ड्स ए हाउस इन ए फॉर्स कॉलोनी ऑफ साउथ एक्सटेंशन इन न्यू दिल्ली एंड स्टेज विद हिज फैमिली देयर. ही डाइज ऑन 11th ऑफ दिसंबर 1999. ही इज वन ऑफ हिज वन अदर सन डाइज ऑन टू इन 2001. Now the family has mother, two sons and one daughter. And in 2005, when amendment comes in the law related to the Hindu succession and related to the shares of daughters in the co-partnery property, the daughter files a suit of partition against her brother. This is the fact of the case of Vinita Sharma versus Rajesh Sharma, in which was the leading case and which was decided by Delhi High Court, and then it became a legal lead case in the batch of appeals filed before the Supreme Court, and Delhi High Court granted a certificate of fitness for filing the appeal before the Supreme Court, because there was a conflicting judgments of Supreme Court on the issue of co-partnery right and the applicability date. These two Supreme Court judgments which were conflicting were Prakash versus Phulwati, and other was Dhammama versus Suman Surpur versus Amar, and Mangalam versus T.B. Razu. Let us understand the matter in simple words. First, what is co-partnery? What was the all dispute about? This co-partnery is made of two words. Co and partnery. Co means equal and partnery means inheritance. In simple words, I can say that it is equal inheritance in property in Hindu succession. This co-partnery stands for. Then who is co-partner? He or she is a person who assumes a legal right in the ancestral property by birth is co-partner. Then how it is important? It is important because the property inherited as co-partnery in a Hindu joint family or Hindu undivided family is passed through on through family descent and held jointly. And it was cleared by Supreme Court in this judgment of Vinita case that the co-partner has the right to demand a partition. So property is there, and by co-partnery the right to demand partition accrues. What were the significant changes which were brought in Hindu Succession Act in 2005? Please understand that prior to 2005, the co-partnery right on birth was conferred or granted only on sons or grandsons. The daughters were left out from acquiring the co-partnery rights. But this situation changed in 2005, and a daughter is also made co-partner, and she got equal right available as it is available to the son. So if this was so clear, then what was the confusion, and how this present journey of cases which lead to the final judgment by the Supreme Court in present case? So please understand that in 2015, a judgment came in the name of Prakash versus Phulwati. The Supreme Court held that the rights under the amendments are applicable to living daughters of living co-partners as on 9th September 2005, irrespective of when the daughters are born. So a cutoff line was given. A cutoff line for applicability of amendment to daughter is taken as 9th September 2005, the date on which the amendment came into effect. In other words, if the father has passed away prior to September 9th 2005, then the living daughter of the co-partner would have no right of co-partner in the co-partnery property. So this was the confusion, because this judgment clearly stated that the date 9th September 2005 is very important for claiming the co-partnery right. Then the situation changes in 2018, when the Supreme Court held that the 2005 amendment confers upon the daughter the status of a co-partner and her in her own right, and the same manner as the son. Thus, it confers equal rights and liabilities in copartner properties to daughters and sons, no matter when it is his father dies. In 2018, a three-judge bench headed by Justice A.K. Sikri had noted that the matter needed to be heard by a three-judge bench to settle the contradiction between the two coordinate benches. So, the issue before Supreme Court in the present Vinita Sharma versus Rakesh Sharma was the following. And this issue was decided by three judges bench headed by Justice Arun Mishra with other judges were Justice S. Nazir and Justice M.P. Shah. So, the issue was whether a daughter could be denied her share on the ground that she was born prior to the enactment of Act 2005 and therefore cannot be treated as copartner. Here I would like to share the submissions made by Sri Tushar Mehta, Solicitor General of India. Appearing on behalf of Union of India, he submitted two basic points. First, the Amendment Act 2005 is not retrospective, but it is retroactive in operations since it enables the daughters to exercise their right as a copartner. The right of copartner accrues to the daughter by birth because the copartnery is a birthright. These two submissions of Tushar Mehta was duly appreciated by the court. The other advocate, the senior advocate who was appointed as amicus curiae, was Mr. R. Venkata Ramani. He submitted that the Hindu joint family is a purely creature of law and cannot be created by the act of the parties. By the expression used in the amendment 6 and 6, the daughter becomes co-partner by birth. He also gave the same argument. The retrospective effect is not intended to be given to the provision of 6. Here he differs from the submission that though equality was bought in 2005, the incidence of birth of a daughter before 2005 is of no consequences. So, and he was just Mr. Venkata Ramani was of opinion that we should not go prior the cases prior to 2005 and reopen the cases of past transactions. Basically, he was apprehensive about the opening of the cases which were decided and which where the partition had already taken place prior to 2005. He also had apprehension about the oral partition and family settlement, and he was of the view that should not be opened. And further, he said that if a daughter is treated as co-partner at any point of time in the past before the amendment, the same will bring enormous uncertainty and working of law. It can be stated that the parliament was not intended to scramble or the uncrambled egg to resurrect the past. What I find that basically he has apprehension of opening of the Pandora box and a surge of litigations. The other advocate who was also a amicus curiae was Mr. V.V.S. Rao. He spoke, he had given very categorical submissions about the section 6, subsection 1A, which declares the daughter to be a copartner by birthright, and by this declaration, the daughter stands included in a copartnery. So, as a declaration is to given the effect, the daughter is to become copartner by birth, and the question of prospectivity or retrospectivity will not arise. So the daughter, whether born before 2005 or after 2005, once she gets the status of copartner, she gets the status of copartner. Then after hearing the detailed argument given by this very learned advocates, the court held that the provisions contained in substituted section 6 of Hindu Succession Act 1956 confers status of copartner on the daughter born before or after the amendment in the same manner as it is given to the son, and the same rights and liabilities accrues to daughter. The second important point was held by the court was the rights can be claimed by the daughter born earlier with effect from 9/9/2005. If the deposition or alienation, partition or testamentary disposition had taken place before 28th day of December 2004. Now, the question is whether a daughter could be denied the right, as father is not alive on 9-9-2005. Since the right is copassionary is by birth, so it is not material and it is not necessary that father should be alive as on 9th September 2005. Then what about the oral partition, the apprehensions which were shown by the learned counsel, Mr. Venkatramani, who was appointed amicus curiae? What about those apprehensions? What about the oral partition of prior to amendments and mostly taken, because this oral partition is mostly taken as defense? So what about that? The court very categorically held in this case that as regards the oral partition, the court said that the plea of oral partition cannot be accepted as a statutorily recognized mode of partition given effect by a duly registered document. Unless it is given by a duly registered document, a plea of partition based on oral evidence alone cannot be accepted and has to be rejected outrightly. So this judgment has settled the ambiguity surrounding the nature and the extent of the daughter's right in a HUF property. It has finally settled a disputed question of law, and the clarification was vital in setting aside the grip on previous decisions accorded copassionary rights to the daughter. Only if both father and daughter were alive as on 9th of September 2005. All persons, whether lawyers or laymen, have equally welcomed this judgment given by the Supreme Court. It is a very progressive judgment, according to me. This has cleared all the doubts and confusions regarding the date. And now, on this today, it is the 74th Independence Day. This is a kind of gift given by the Supreme Court to the women in India. Thank you very much for watching this video. Please share your views in the comment sections. Please like as well as subscribe my channel. Thank you very much. Namaskar.